Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his soul. Time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then your holy name.
thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness.
Resurrection, and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning we are renewed. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me." I'm sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our sister Esme for burial. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise her to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, remember before you today our sister Esme, We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Please be seated. We will now have the eulogy by Freddie Ford.
My friends in Christ, a blessed good afternoon to you. As we assemble here in the sacred space of St. Barnabas Anglican Church to pay homage to Esmer Verona Ford, née Clark. Esmer left her earthly sojourn to steal away home to Jesus on March 12, 2023, at the ripe old age of 91 years. My name is Frederick Ford. Esmer Verona was my aunt-in-law, and I knew her for more than 60 years. I used to live two houses away from the home she occupied with my uncle Livingston and their children. I experienced a very healthy relationship with Esmer and her children. She always carried a genuinely happy smile whenever I visited her. Esmer was born on April 30th, 1931, to Louise and James Clark, who lived at Coconut Grove, St. Joseph. Her early life was not unlike that of children of her era. School, church, and home chores were the order of the day. And village life was an indispensable instrument of the socialization process. It is true to say that in her childhood, the village was an integral part of raising the children. Therefore, Esmer Verona benefited from the love, security, and spiritual guidance from her family, as well as from adults in her neighborhood. She had a Christian upbringing and enjoyed living her life in honor and glory to and in the just fear of God, our Lord and Savior. I am informed that Esmer's father, James, made a living to support his family by being a hard-working hawker. This type of vending entrepreneurship was the way of industry then, as it is now, a noble and honest way for ordinary folks to put food on the table for their families. Esmer put food on the table for her own family by dint of hard work. She worked at the Barbados Marketing Corporation for several years, and for many years at the Ocean View Hotel, where she demonstrated her great culinary skills. She also possessed very good needlework skills and enjoyed cleaning and washing the old-fashioned way. Esmer was a Christian-minded lady, And when she moved to Mount Friendship to be with my Uncle Livingston, who predeceased her a few years ago, she worshiped here at St. Barnabas Church, where she was further exposed to and enlightened on the Word. She understood and knew the power of God's love, His assurances to be always with us, and the tremendous blessings He promised to bestow on us, as presented in Psalm 19, especially verses 7 to 9, which I repeat here now. 7, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. End the quote. My friends in Christ, below are a few encomiums that give us a little peek into who Esmer was, and that truly reflect the high esteem in which she was held by her family and other persons who knew and interacted with her. Her children gave some insights into her life and witness. They fervently give similar glowing recollections that will forever be etched in their memories. For example, Mom gave us unconditional motherly love. She exhibited a cool, calm, and pleasant disposition virtually all the time. Mom was a disciplinarian who did not tolerate foolishness, but applied corporal punishment sparingly. But as she matured into the art and science of parenting, corporal punishment was not used. Daddy would have to be the one to use it. She loved to share things with people and embrace everyone. She loved to cook tasty or delicious dishes and waited until everyone came home from school so that we can all eat together. We learned to cook, clean, and be industrious because of Mommy. She was a very good seamstress, and she could literally stitch clothing without using a machine. She was a contented soul who hardly complained about anything. One time when the washing machine broke down, she was happy to go outside and wash her clothes the old-fashioned way. But she was very surprised and also very pleased when one of her daughters purchased one for her eventually. She loved to watch movies with us and possessed a good sense of humor. Her children expressed deep love and admiration for their mom. Her grandson Matthew related how, as a child growing up, his grandmother was one of the people he spent a lot of time with. Every school holiday, especially the summer vacation, he spent all 9 weeks with her, and she would always spoil him by trying to give him something to eat, even if it were just biscuits or nuts. He passionately said, "I will never forget her and will love and miss her always." Her granddaughter, Nicole, recalled waiting on evenings for Granny to come home because something yummy was going to be provided. And regardless of how many persons were waiting for goodies, there was something for everyone. Mummy loved to watch fun and kung fu movies. You could have heard her laughing when you were at top of the hill, that is the top of Mount Friendship Hill. Mummy was known for her food, and we will miss her kuku and pork stew. You could smell her pot miles away, and the guys would come and shout, "Mummy Ford, I out here, pot smell good." And the guys were sure to get a share. You could not come home and say somebody beat you. Mummy's first question would be, "What are you feeding Winner for?" Even at the baby sibling pointed out that you could hear her mom shouting, "Kiki, Cuffy," when she was watching one of her favorite shows, Bonanza. A member of the nursing staff at the St. Michael District Hospital, where Esme spent her last few years, indicated that Izzy, as she was affectionately called by the staff of Ward 8A, was not a talkative person, but when she spoke, she provided comic relief to the staff. Those of us who would have been aware of nursing care and taking care of people, respite is very important. Without respite, you will go and leave the person you were taking care of. The staff invoked the name of her daughter, Marcia, as a means to get her to eat her meals, take her showers, and follow instructions. My fellow God-fearing soldiers, Esmea Verona lived a relatively quiet and peaceful life, focused on nurturing her children to adulthood and inculcating in them a sense of goodness. She had a good, solid value system. For example, hard work, fairness, caring and giving, self-reliance, self-respect, respect and love for her fellow men. She practiced temperance in her daily life. Her personality did not allow her to go overboard about anything, not even a Western or a Kung Fu movie. Her earthly pilgrimage may be summed up in the words of the outstanding orator, reformist, and Anglican clergyman, Frederick William Robertson, also called Robertson of Brighton. "Do right, and God's recompense to you will be the power of doing more right. Give, and God's reward to you will be the spirit of giving more." A blessed spirit, for it is the spirit of God himself whose life is the blessedness of giving. Love, and God will pay you with the capacity of even more love. For love is heaven. Love is God within you. My dear people, Esme possessed the spirit of God within her heart and her being. We can all do well by following the above enjoiner that can help to lead us towards the Master's great gift of exaltation. And finally, the family of the late Esme Verona Ford deeply appreciates your presence, prayers, kindness, and support in this trying period of their lives. Special thanks and gratitude are extended to the nurses, doctors, and support staff of the St. Michael District Hospital, and today, the rector, organist, and members of the choir, and the entire church family here at St. Barnabas. A special acknowledgement is also in order for her daughter Marcia, who lived with her mom and was her primary caregiver before she was admitted to hospital. Esme is survived by her children, Grantley, Brenda, Marcia, Sonia, Celestine, Judy, Sonia, Anthony, and Yvonette, and many grandchildren and great-grandchildren, her brother, Hilton, and his sister, Myra, and many other relatives. Esme, we all love you. May you rest in peace and rise in glory at the trumpet sound. Thank you.
Please remain seated while we have a tribute in song by Coralie Allen.
Good evening, everybody. My contribution here is as a result of being around this family for a lot of years. Nicole, who happens to be her granddaughter, was a school friend of mine forever, and we're still friends. Her daughter is my goddaughter. So that will tell you about my, you know, me being around them for all this year. So I didn't know what to sing because I didn't have a song, but I came up with this one, and everybody knows it. And if you know it, you can sing along with me.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the day rests and bears. For a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I would cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dead Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it on dark Calvary.
Sing along if you know it.
The old rugged cross, stained so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last lay down. I would cling to the rugged cross, and His changes someday for a crown, and His changes someday. Someday for a crown, oh crown.
Thank you.
We will now stand and sing the hymn, Angel Voices Ever Singing.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, You have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated. We will now have the first scripture reading by Antonio O'Neill Drum.
Good evening, church. The first lesson is taken from Paul's letters to the apostle to Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 14 to 19. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please remain seated while we chant the 46th Psalm.
Thank you.
We will now have the second scripture reading by Judy Clark.
Good evening, church. Reading from the Word of God, since John's Gospel, chapter 11, verse 14 to 27. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatsoever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection in the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." This is the word of the Lord.
We will now stand and sing to him, "Blessed Assurance."
Thank you. May I speak to you in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit. Somebody once defined the difference between a pessimist and an optimist in this way. They said, when trouble comes, the pessimist will normally say, it is enough to make a person lose his or her religion. But the optimist will always say, it is enough to make a person use his or her religion. I want to suggest this afternoon that all of us who have a relationship with God in Christ should be optimists. Because if you and I find ourselves in a position where our only hope is God and our only help is to be found in God, then we need not be pessimistic, we need to be optimistic, because it means that we are right where God wants us to be. The psalmist who wrote this 46th psalm that we had this afternoon was definitely an optimist. He says, God is our hope and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. And the psalmist presents us with a truth that you and I can build on, a truth that will carry us through the storms of life, a truth that will be there with us in the furious floods that we face as we make our way through life. And if you want any one of us here this afternoon is feeling helpless, any one of us is feeling hopeless and in need of hope, we need to listen again to the words of this psalm. For this psalm gives us a foundation on which our lives can stand in the face of the storms of life. For in this psalm, what the writer has done and what he is calling upon us to do when we are in trouble is not to look in every place except the right place, not to try everything except the right thing, not to ask every person except the right person, not to go into every avenue and find it a dead end. He is saying to us that when we find ourselves amidst the trials of life, that we should seek to find strength in the presence and power of God. You know, one thing that is common to all of us is that we will all have our crises in life. You have problems, I have problems, our homes face problems, the church has problems, our government has problems, the nation has problems. And the answer to the problems of life are not to be found in the halls of humanistic living. The answer to the problems of life are not to be found in the halls of higher learning. The answer to the problems of life are to be found in the presence of a holy God. Life happens, my friends. You and I we'll all be shaken at some time by the tremors and trials and troubles and tribulations of life. There will be times when you and I will feel that the ground under our feet is shaking and quaking. And these are the times that God will always give us that which will be necessary for us to overcome and to be victorious. The psalmist in the 121st psalm says, my help comes even from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And I wonder this afternoon if you and I can think of anyone or anything that you and I would rather have as our helper other than the God who created us. I am talking about the God who created this world with a word and can one day cremate this world with a whisper. I am talking about the God of whom we are told in Proverbs that he is the great God who formed all things. I am talking about the God of whom the prophet Jeremiah confessed that he is the God and there is nothing too hard for this God to do. My friends, let us not forget that the God who created this world is the God who controls this world. Sometimes we as human beings get the impression that we are in control of God's world, but that is not true, for this is God's world, and with this world, God chooses to do what God chooses to do. The psalmist says to us again, but our God is in heaven, and he does whatever he pleases. And therefore, in our times of trouble, God is our help. In our time of tragedy, God is our hope. And if we could only realize how powerful our God is, we would understand that when God is the only help we have, God is also the only help we need. And every now and then, the adversities of life may land us a serious setback, and they may cause us to stagger, but if we have confidence in Almighty God, you and I can stand firm. For we believe in a God who will not allow our feet to be moved. The word for move in that psalm, it means to slip, and one of the greatest promises in Scripture is found in the book of Proverbs, where the writer of the book of Proverbs tells us, do not be afraid of sudden terror, nor troubled from the wicked when it comes, for the Lord will be your confidence and keep your foot from being caught. My friends, the feet that are standing on the solid rock of Christ can never slip and will never slumber. When others are falling and flailing around us, the person who believes in God, the person who stands for and with God, will not and cannot fall. And the God that we are talking about is a God who is constantly alert every single day of our lives. And the reason why you and I are able to go to sleep at night is because the God that we worship is a God who does not sleep. I had a good friend who always used to say to me, Rev, the Lord does wear pajamas, but he don't sleep. And I understood what he meant. For the God whom we worship is a God who is constantly watching over every single one of us. For our God does not slumber, and our God does not sleep. God is not only our provider, but God is our protector. God always stands with us at our most vulnerable points in our lives, and he always puts his strength at our greatest point of weakness. God deliberately takes up a position so that God can defend us no matter where an attack may come from. And that is why, again, every one of us who believe in God must be an optimist. For the writer of Psalm 18 tells us, he is a shield for all those who trust in him. My friends, the psalmist is saying to us that our God is a God who will keep us. But that this God does not just protect us, but that this God preserves us as human beings. And therefore, this afternoon, I want to assure you that our God will not only be faithful to the end, that our God will be faithful beyond the end. And when you and I feel that we are at the end of our rope, that you and I have come to a dead end in this journey, and we feel that the enemy is going to win over us, whether that enemy be disease, disappointment, discouragement, or even death, we need to remember who our God is and what our God can do. My friends, when people abandon us, we need to remember that God is our provider. When foes attacked us, we need to remember that God is our protector. When fears assail us, we need to remember that God is our preserver, and we do not stand alone in the face of all these things. And that is why we can be optimistic today, because even in the face of death, in the face of the death of someone whom we love and cared for, you and I can still be optimistic because we know that death is not the end. Our sister Esme, like the rest of us, would have had her trials and tribulations in life. She would have experienced the ups and downs of life, and her faith in God would have kept her going. For God was her hope and strength. And therefore today you and I can come and gather in this, the house of God, and commit and commend her to this God, a God who is truly her preserver, a God who was her provider, a God who was her protector, and a God who is willing to take her unto himself, a God who in God's Son has overcome death and has promised eternal life to each and every one of us. My friends, we are optimistic because we have that kind of faith in God. To those of you who mourn the passing of our dear sister, we want you to take heart from these words and recognize that for her, life has changed, not ended. For she has gone to be with a God whom she worshiped, a God whom she loved, and a God who cared for her, having made her in his image. And therefore, we, to you who mourn her loss, we want to extend our condolences. And we pray that rest eternal may be granted unto her, and that light perpetual may forever shine upon her. May she rest in peace, and may she rise in glory. Amen.
Please stand. Repeat the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Please sit as we bow our heads in prayer. For our sister Esme Verona, let us pray to the Lord Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near as we mourn for Esme Verona and dry the tears of those who weep. Hear us, Lord. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. Hear us, Lord. You raised the dead to life. Raise our sister to eternal life. Hear us, Lord. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven. Hear us, Lord. Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints. Hear us, Lord. She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Hear us, Lord. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation, and eternal life our hope.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints.
Your sorrow and pain are no more, nor the sight, but life everlasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to the earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created us, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our sound. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Let us commend our sister Esme Verona to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant, O Sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set her free from every bond, that she may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Esme. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. On the behalf of the parish family here at St. Barnabas, we'd like to extend to you our deepest condolences to assure you of our prayerful support in this, your time of grief. During the singing of the next hymn, a collection will be taken that will go towards the organ fund of this church in memory of our departed sister.
Thank you.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down but death by death, and giving life to those in the tomb. The Son of Righteousness is gloriously risen, giving light to those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death. The Lord will guide our feet into the way of peace, having taken away the sin of the world. Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name, saying, "Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. Into paradise may the angels lead you. At your coming, may the martyrs receive you and bring you into the holy city, Jerusalem."
We agree. Amen.